Danger, Tiger Crossing by Lynn Oliver. Chapter 8. We've got to get out of here, I told Luna and David.
I've been running from that tiger for a while now, David said. He doesn't give up easily.
How have you escaped him? I asked.
All kinds of ways. Once I climbed a tree that was so high the branches at the top couldn't hold him. He gave up and he climbed down. Another time, I hid in a troop of wild monkeys. Once an eagle swooped down and distracted him. He chased the eagle and I ran in the other direction.
Well, that was lucky, said Luna, but we can't count on a bird showing up just when we need one.
Well, we can hatch our own bird, I said.
How exactly do we do that? David asked.
Unless you're sitting on an egg you haven't told us about.
Luna, give me your hat, I said.
I think I know where you're going with this, she said with a little smile. She took off her hat and handed it to me. The feathers were wet and muddy from the river, but that worked out well for my plan. I put the helicopter in front of me and wrapped the hat around it.
Does that look anything like a bird? I asked.
It will when I'm finished with it, Luna said.
She arranged the feathers carefully, bunching some of them to look like wings. Others she shaped into a tail, and then she took a brown clip out of her hair and snapped it on the front.
It can't be a bird if it doesn't have a beak, she said.
I hope this thing isn't too heavy to fly, I said. I picked up the remote and pressed the throttle. The whirring started up, and slowly the helicopter rose into the air.
We have liftoff, I cried.
The feathery thing circled the cave. It wasn't the most real-looking bird I've ever seen, but it wasn't bad either.
Do you think it'll trick the tiger? Luna asked me.
We have a shot. Maybe to tiger eyes this will look like a delicious turkey dinner. The sound of the whirring had excited the tiger again. His paw clawed even faster at the ground. The boulder wiggled a bit. He was making progress.
So here's the big question, Luna said. How do we get out of the cave and launch this thing without a tiger snatching us?
We were quiet. That was a tough question. Then David got up and took the controller from my hand.
You mind if I try operating this? He asked. It looks like fun.
This really isn't the best time to be playing with toys, I told him, but by that time, he already had his hands on the throttle. The bird-like helicopter zoomed wildly in the air. It looked like it was going to crash into the cave wall.
You have to control it, I said. Press the throttle to the left. Now right. Now down. Go good, good. Go easy. Just hover 2 or 3 feet off the ground.
I'm getting it, David said.
That's good. Now maybe you should stop playing with it. We have to figure out how to get out of here.
I already have, said David. Here's the plan. I'll go out first. I'll hover the helicopter right in front of the tiger's nose, and then whoosh, I'll send it flying in the air. With any luck, he'll take off after it, and you guys can sneak out and run in the opposite direction back to the river.
Well, what about you? I asked.
Don't worry about me, he said. I know my way around this jungle. I'll meet up with you.
Maybe we should wait until it's dark out.
We can't, I said, looking at my Batman watch.
It's almost 5 o'clock.
So, what happens then?
Well, if my theory is right, that's when the magic hour ends, the hour of power.
Tiger, what are you talking about? Luna asked.
Remember when Viola talked about how the frame had an hour of power? I think it's from 4 to 5 o'clock, and that's why the frame's powers got active when I set the clock to 4. And I bet at 5, they're over.
Luna rubbed her chin like she was thinking hard. And after that, whoever is left inside the painting stays inside?
That's what I think.
Well, that would explain what happened to me, said David. I was tossing about for hours in that storm, and when I finally woke up in the grand hotel of the castle with all those strange paintings around me, it was way past 5.
But if we're back in the very same spot where we landed at 5 o'clock, then maybe we'll be able to go back into the painting and return home, I said. It's our only hope, anyway.
Do you know what this means, David? Said Luna. If Tiger's theory is right, you can come home with us.
Luna broke into a big smile and threw her arms around him. That was a brave thing to do, considering he hadn't taken a bath in 50 years.
Let's just get out of this cave first, is all he said.
I pointed to my watch. It was nearing 5 o'clock.
We don't have long. We have to move fast. David, are you ready?
Let's fly this thing, he said.
He took the helicopter and he placed it at the mouth of the cave.
tiger had removed his paw, but I could hear him sniffing at the entrance. He smelled human flesh. "Good luck, everyone," David said. He stuck his head out of the opening, and then, quick as a cheetah, he squirmed out of the cave. As soon as he was out, I heard the whirring of the helicopter. "We have liftoff," David yelled. I crept over to the opening and peeked outside. I saw the helicopter hovering in midair, a few feet from the cave entrance. The tiger was tracking it with his eyes. David was behind one of the boulders, his hand clutching the controller. "Okay, boy," David whispered, "let's see what you've got." He pushed his thumb on the throttle and the helicopter zoomed through the air. The tiger followed it with his glowing eyes. All at once, he sprang to his feet. Turning his powerful body in the direction of the helicopter, he took off running. The chase was on.